Next Sunday evening, we're starting a new outreach ministry. We're having a worship service here on Sunday evening. We're inviting people, I know you can read, but inviting people to gather for some coffee and refreshments, to worship together in our Reformed typical style of worship in the sense of our orthodoxy and what we're preaching, but in a more relaxed, casual way. We'll have live music, we'll sing some praise songs together, we'll hear God's word together, and then we'll have a time of fellowship. We'll have some dinner together afterwards. There will be some handouts that hopefully you'll see around town if you'd like to be part of passing some of them out. Jackie's making those for us, and so we're excited about this new beginning next Sunday evening. What else? Anything else to mention?
I mentioned that next Sunday after worship, we will have a fellowship half hour as well, hosted by you'll see in the bulletin membership and events and personnel and finance. There's a session meeting on Tuesday, this coming Tuesday. At what time is it?
6:30, and we're going to have a report of the personnel committee and have a brief meeting about budget, is my understanding. Is that Elder's nod, if that's what you think we're doing on Tuesday? Okay, good, thank you. All right, we are set up this morning, taking advantage of the beautiful cloth that was here for Advent and Christmas. We're worshiping in a style a little bit like today. Some of you have been to Tuesday services. Those services are usually beautifully lit by candles, and the time is kind of claimed for quiet and reflection. I decided, knowing myself and you, that while typically a Tuesday service, you sit in silence for maybe 15 minutes, that maybe most of us would fall asleep this morning if we sat that long. So instead, I decided to do something just with the style and the beauty of it. And so we're going to worship together. Susan is going to lead us in a responsive piece. You'll notice if you take just a moment that the bulletin is a little different, just a slightly different in style. And how we're going to go through the pieces together. Most notably, I think that instead of having our time of confession and pardon and sharing the peace, that's going to be right before we share the peace together. So we're going to focus on how we start the new year by being right with God and each other. So that's why that peace is there. All right, so we're going to begin our worship. After we sing our first two songs of praise, or during, and if you'd like, we'll invite people to come up and light candles if they'd like out here to be part of that.
We think we're lighting the Advent candles this morning, so yes. All candles up here are very good.
Right. If you'd like to come forward any time during that singing or after that and light some candles, that would be wonderful to be part of that. All right, well, let's stand together for the call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will be glad in your sins. This is the year the Lord has begun. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning.
Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him.
Join with me in the responsive reading from Psalm 98, a new song. Sing to the Lord a new song because he has done miracles. By his right hand and holy arm, he has won the victory.
Angels sing,
Lord, Lord,
a new name, selected verses from Isaiah 62. Regarding Zion, I cannot keep my mouth shut. Regarding Jerusalem, I cannot hold my tongue. Until her righteousness blazes down like the sun, her salvation flames up like a torch. Foreign nations will see your righteousness and world leaders your glory. You'll get a brand new name straight from the mouth of God. You'll be a stunning crown in the palm of God's hand, a jeweled gold cup held high in the hand of your God. No more will anyone call you rejected, and your country will no more be called ruined. Yes, God has broadcast to all the world, tell daughters, Zion, look, your Savior comes, ready to do what he said he'd do, prepared to complete what he promised. At this point, we're going to receive our morning offering, and so we invite you to the time of sharing of the gifts that we have for the purposes of God's kingdom.
Thank you.
for the chance to spend time with extended family, for family and friends, and for safe travel. For God's healing power and mercy, for my daughter getting a job, praise God. And we have a praise report for Anne, for Aldine's mom, who is has gone to live at the Mon Valley Care Center. She's doing well, better than expected, and please keep her in this transition and Aldine as well in your prayers. So it's a mixture of the struggles with change, as you know, but also a strong new beginning in this chapter. So keep them both in your prayers. I have other praise reports that you lift up this morning.
For Susan's wonderful and rousing and offertory.
Yes, indeed. For that means it was awesome. Rousing is the right word. That's wonderful. Thank you. And for all the music, for Susan and the choir and soloists for this whole season. Are there other things that she would lift up in praise reports this morning? Yes.
After 3 months, I got to see my grandson in the holidays.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Praise God for that. Are there others? Prayer concerns for safe travel. For my daughter, who is going through a rough time. For Ginny Jones, for good health for the new year. For an upcoming medical test. For Chuck, is it Shine? Serious injuries following a car accident. For Barb Saxon with dementia. Praying for a cure for MS. And praying for our government. Are there other prayer concerns that you would lift up as well? Faith steps for a new year in the Lord. Amen to that. And let's go to our Father in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity we get. For the ways as we walk past each other, we can hear each other singing. For the ways that we will be passing the peace, your peace. For the ways together we are here as individuals, carrying our own joys and our own burdens, but we become so different and so much more like you when we gather together. So we thank you for the ways that you are in us individually in your spirit, but also for the glorious ways that you shape us and change us and magnify who you are in us when we gather together. Thank you for the privilege it is to pray with others to you. We thank you for the ways that you have taken us through all the days until now and have always been faithful to us. Always been faithful to us. And because of that testimony in our own lives and the being reminded by others around us, we know that you will always be faithful, that you will never let us go and you will never let us down as we walk into this new year. Thank you for the joys this time has brought, for the hopes and dreams and excitement we have, for healings and miracles we've seen, and chances to be together, and for the way that you've made a path into this new year for us to walk into, and we praise you. We're grateful for that. Pray, Lord, for that new year and the transitions all of us will go through in it. Thank you, particularly that you're with Ann and Aldine today, and that you're with others that are walking through this time in ways that they're not quite sure what the next step might be, but that we know that you're a good God and that you're with us. Pray for all of the anxieties that we bring into this year, all the circumstances, all the brokenness, all the wondering what it will mean. Thank you, Lord, that you are with people struggling with anxiety for test results or what the next step might be in a job search or a relationship that isn't what it should be, that you are there and that you are unshakably for us, and that you will work out your miracles indeed, and that we will live to tell the stories of your glory. Thank you, Lord, that you let us be your agents of hope, even as we feel broken, that we are still able to comfort others, your scripture says, with the comfort that we have been given. And so we thank you even for our trials, for they have made us more like you. Thank you, Lord, that we can come together in this place at this time as sisters and brothers and call upon you as our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, listen to this New Testament reading. First Peter. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Join with me in a response of thanksgiving. For the work of Jesus Christ, we belong to him. Let us discover anew and accept with new assurance that we are who God says we are, holy and redeemed people who belong to him.
Things that were, they were in contact.
do that, but I already had you come forward and light candles, and I thought maybe you'd get a little annoyed with me for getting involved. It is satisfying. It was satisfying to me, and I knew what I was going to do. But maybe it's not everything I need to start the new year. How exactly do we walk through and into this time and into the new year, 2016, knowing that God has made a way for us, knowing, though, that the Lord is definitely going to notice the mess we made, you know? There's no way to have me stand here and think, well, he's just not going to notice that I messed that up last year, that we're not all who we should be. The transition this time of year is hard for me. There must be someone out there who feels a little bit melancholy at the beginning of January. I miss all the beauty, the expectation, the gatherings, the meals, the presents, the hope, and then after New Year's, it feels all like leftovers, a little bit. Feels like the beautiful pieces of wrapping paper that I'm still taking out from under my couch, you know? It's still there, and I know it was all good, and I don't really want to go back, but I miss all that expectation. And then I look for the New Year, and then I gather up the hope, and the new plans, and the new start, all the things that I think I'm going to do differently this year. And then I realize that what I have to work with isn't all my little Advent gifts that I had lined up only a few weeks ago, or a pretty Advent calendar with little birds on it or whatever. You know, I don't have any of that anymore. All I have as I walk into the new year is me. Doesn't feel like a whole lot to work with. And I have a world around me just like you that seems just a little more complicated than maybe a shredder or wishful positive thinking or a list of how this year is going to be different can manage. It's complicated. There's all the joy and blessings and love mixed into the new year. There's also the reality of loss and struggle and some things that are just messed up. And then I remembered, just like you do, that if I can peel my eyes away from all of the things I've used to distract myself, and all the 24-hour news cycle, and all the bad news that keeps pouring in long enough, that maybe I can remember and remind you that the turmoil in this world could be more in tune than the world that Christ himself was born into. He was born into a land controlled by an empire that he wasn't a member of. He was born in the midst of a system that gave protection to some people in it, but not others, certainly not him. He was born into a time where he was such a threat that Herod slaughtered everyone under the age of 2 just to try and wipe out the Prince of Peace. So I remind myself and you that we are living in a very biblical time, a very original Christmas time. Because when God came to us in Emmanuel, God chose to enter a time that is violent and faithless, just like our own. And he came to save sinners smack in the middle of the mess they've made of things. How were people prepared to receive him, to walk into that Christmas time, to walk into the time when Jesus first started to preach the gospel? By remembering who God was, by remembering who they are, and receiving God's way to start again, not by good intentions, not by happy, positive thinking, not by trying harder, but by repentance and forgiveness and reconciliation and freedom. People were prepared to receive Christ by first admitting that they needed him. And to be clear, repentance, which I actually think is a very lovely thing to start the new year with, repentance. Repentance isn't about feeling bad. Repentance is about seeing, freeing yourself from holding on to all your mess and all your junk and all your stuff. Repentance is about freedom. It's about being changed. And you know all those people that first came at the beginning of Jesus' ministry down to the river to be forgiven and baptized? Who were those people? They were the people who knew they needed it, just like us, or we wouldn't be here. They came in streams of people who had guilty consciences, who were sexist and racist and liars. Those people who were emotionally manipulated, and the ones that manipulated others to get what they wanted. They came, all of them, the greedy ones, to lay down their mess and mistakes and coping mechanisms and their PR routine. That was good news. They all came. Notice I didn't ask you to raise your hands when I went through the list, because we can all find ourselves in that story, that list of who needed to repent. Because repentance is not about feeling bad. I'm not trying to make you feel bad this morning before we're forgiven and we share peace. Feeling bad is easy, amen? Feeling bad is easy. Repentance is about change. And in this world, we do in fact need systemic change. We need legislative change, institutional change, government change. Don't mistake me, I know that that's true. But I can't remain unchanged, and you can't remain unchanged, and expect to have any impact on a world that is this badly broken. When we all get together, we confess together, and we receive a chance to start again. When we're all together, you're with your friends, I'm sure over the holidays you start to talk about the world as it is, and we get all upset and angry, pointing our finger at other people, how bad the world is, and how could they, and why won't they, and all those things. But all that kind of anger is a little bit like eating a whole lot of fill-in-the-blanks of your favorite candy. I'll say candy corn. It's like eating a bunch of candy corn or caramel-covered popcorn. It feels good for a while to eat the candy, right? It feels real good for a while to eat the candy. But after a while, you kind of crash on that high of the sugar, or in our case, self-righteousness. Can I be that bold? You kind of get so full of yourselves, and aren't we right, and aren't they wrong, and then you stop and you realize it's just empty calories. I can't eat more. It's empty words just to point your finger at other people and not do something else about it. If I were to be honest, I would tell you that in addition to all of the many sins that you could probably list quicker than I could about myself, I also am troubled by the fact that I'm not even troubled enough about the world. You know what I mean? We complain about the world and then we go on and see a movie. Go shopping. Have a party. It's easy to be us in some ways here. And again, it's complicated. And I'll tell you what it is, that it is a relief in the middle of this mess that I'm laying out for you, reminding you of all my sins and yours, and here we are together, the world is broken. It is, thank you, Jesus, a relief. Because the way we go forward is by repenting and knowing the sweet forgiveness that Jesus brings, and sharing a feast together and being strengthened together to go out into the world. Because I believe, and I know you do too, that God wants to be known and received by us. God gets how hard it is for us to do this, especially when we're busy alternating between being right and feeling so bad about everything. And so today, in this time, in this place, let us repent. I call us to repentance. Let us be a people changed by God, because in the tender compassion of God, we are sent a Savior that we sing about. One who is hard to welcome or really see or appreciate if we keep holding on to all of our junk and all of our stuff. And so from the beginning, God made a new way for us to receive Christ, to put down all the stuff we've held on to before, and let God take it from you and replace it with God's own mercy. I invite you to lay all that down with me before this table and this feast, and receive the Prince of Peace in your heart and in your spirit. Lay down, get rid of what troubles you, and know that having done so, that there is absolutely no chance that God will leave you unchanged as you leave here this morning. And we need that. And I need that. And the world needs that. Amen. I invite us into a time of confession. Don't have words here on purpose, not just because I forgot to put in the bulletin. I invite you to a time of just the briefest of quiet, that you would yourself listen long enough to hear what God would speak to you. Not as condemnation, but an invitation to lay it down. What you've done, what's been done to you, lay it down and let Him come in and love you and forgive you. give you a new beginning. I advise into a time of confession. Let's go to our Lord in prayer. God is gracious and merciful, and slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Loves you and me just as we are, and loves us enough to give us a new way into this new year. I declare to you the amazing truth that the entire forgiveness of your sins is present to all of us who would reach out to Jesus. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Amen.
Lord have mercy is going to be our response this morning. We're going to start with the response that you sing twice. Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, out these verses.
Mercy, Christ, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
people will come from north and south and east and west, wherever, we'll all be at the table together, and I believe that's true, and I know you do. We'll all be together at the feast. This is the appetizer. This is the foretaste of what it will be like when we're all together. And so we celebrate that. I invite you to join me in prayer to receive the feast. Thank you, God, that you called us in this place, that you set us aside for your extraordinary purpose, just like this Jew, just like this bread. That in the midst of this experience, we will be drawn to you in ways that we have not experienced before, and that you surely have given us this gift to strengthen us, to be reconciled to you and with others. And thank you, Christian. Amen. That night before he gave his life for us, Jesus turned to all of those, and I invite you to hear the invitation through my words, but from him. And he looked at you, and he said, this is my body, broken for you, for you. After he gave thanks, he said, take this and eat this and remember me. The same way, he took the cup, and instead of thinking about it as wine, he said the truth. That this is the new covenant, the new unbreakable promise I'm making to you, to all of you, to me. Unbreakable promise in Christ's blood, that he will indeed come again for us, that we're reconciled, that we're saved for God. That every time we eat the bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the truth of what he's done for us and he'll come again. People of God, receive the feast, the table.
Thank you. one who's also mighty to save, though from the shore to power that God has set forth, great faith out for everyone. Amen.